United Methodist founder is John Wesley, lived in England a couple hundred years ago. In England, you know, there was lots of problems, and among other things that he addressed in his preaching and teaching and his actions were that they condemned slavery. And he did it on numerous occasions. And as a matter of fact, 6 days before his death, he wrote a letter to William Wilberforce, who was a British parliamentary leader in the fight against slave trade. And this is what he said. Be not weary in well-doing. Go on in the name of God and in the power of God's might to abolish slavery in any form, which is the vilest thing under the sun, until it vanishes away before it. So there's 4 million United Methodists worldwide, and we're guided by lots of things, the Bible, our theological statements, but we also have what's called the social principles. And in the social principles, we reflect our responsibility to care for the natural world, creation, the economic community, the world community, the social community, and the nurturing community. And under the nurturing community, it says, among other things, we deplore all forms of the commercialization, the abuse, and the exploitation of sex. We call for strict enforcement of laws protecting the sexual exploitation of children, women, and men, and for adequate protection, guidance, and counseling for them. The United Methodist Church has several divisions. One of them is called the Church and Society. It's a general board that's based in Washington, D.C. They are involved in human trafficking on a national, international, and local level. They say, human trafficking is a violation of the human and civil rights that enslaves thousands of people across the globe. And the United States Trafficking Victims Protection Act defines what it is. This is what we support, and this is what we promote worldwide. Sex trafficking, in which a commercial sex act is induced by force, fraud, and coercion, or in which a person included induced to perform such an act has not attained 18 years of age. And we're working to fight recruitment, harboring, transporting, providing, obtaining of a person's labor for the services through the use of force. And they refer to a couple of scripture, other scripture verses from Ecclesiastes. Again, I looked and I saw all the oppression that was taking place under the sun. I saw the tears of the oppressed, and they have no comforter. Power is on the side of the oppressors. They have no comforter. That's from Ecclesiastes 4:1. And then for 2 Corinthians, now the Lord is the Spirit, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So as Christians, we are to be about freeing people from oppression. Okay? And it says, as an Adventist, we proclaim faith in the God of freedom and condemn slavery as wrong and incompatible with Christ's teaching. We recognize that we are called to follow Christ in proclaiming release to the captives and setting the oppressed free. This is what the General Board of Church and Society is doing. They're working in 7 different annual conferences. Minnesota's a conference. If you're not a Methodist, Minnesota's a conference. So around the United States, they're working in 7 different conferences, trying to organize campaigns in communities like this and support groups and supporting people who are doing independently, like Fakola is. They also participate and lobby through the United Nations Commission on the Status and Role of Women, and they have board members from the United Methodist Church on that organization. They also endorse and promote the Rescue and Restore Initiative. We also have women who are involved in United Methodist Women. And one of the emphases of United Methodist Women throughout the years has been human trafficking. United Methodist Women works in 14 different countries against human trafficking.
Hello, my name is Emily Wise. Please join Bukola in the fight against human trafficking by partnering with the Anytown Story. Their mission is to advocate for victims and empower survivors of human trafficking. For more information on that, you can go to or email info@anytown.org. Once a month, we have the Empowerment Circle. You can find more about the Empowerment Circle on our website. Thank you for your time.
Took all of them, all these kids, just for the wants and the needs. I pray for the souls.
About sex trafficking, but do you know that you could be living with a victim of labor trafficking just beside your house? I was a victim of labor trafficking, and there were neighbors who saw me every day but didn't know anything was happening, and they couldn't rescue me for 10 years before I finally got help. And I'm glad today that the attorney who represented me, for me to be able to stand here today in front of you all, will be coming to the podium after the break. Welcome, Salima, and I really thank you. We need to understand that human trafficking can happen to anybody. It's not only homeless children, and it is not only runaway kids. It is not only kids who come from a problematic home, like you think. But someone who has come from a good home, or someone who has even had the education and everything, can become a victim of human trafficking. Some of these are on that sheet. The presentation is actually from that sheet and app. It was a training provided by the Department of Homeland Security to train people about this basic human trafficking. So it's the modern day slavery and it involves false fraud or coercion, and it could be, you know, like I mentioned, sex or labor, and there is organ trafficking that is not being mentioned as much as sex or labor. We need, in the case of human trafficking, we just need to pay more attention and dig more. Sometimes it is in the plain sight, but if we don't look, we're not going to see anything. And even if we're looking and not paying attention, we're not going to see what is going on. And victims are found everywhere, either legitimate or illegitimate places. And these are just few of the places that you can find victims. Sometimes people wonder what human trafficking is and what small game is. For somebody to be small good game, the person has agreed with another person and paid to come across the border. But for human trafficking, the person has not paid somebody to be small good in or be taken over to a different place. And as we hear that it can happen as a result of fraud, cause of coercion, so human trafficking is different. Sometimes, some people who are small good end up becoming victims of human trafficking. But smuggling enough and alone is not enough to determine human trafficking. Human trafficking can, victims can be of any age. Anyone can become a victim of human trafficking. So like I said before, human trafficking is always in our plain sight, but because it's hidden, we can't see. We don't have any victim that will write on his or her forehead, "I am a victim of human trafficking." And even in my case, when I was told that I was a traffic victim, I did not believe it. I said, no, how can I be a victim of human trafficking? No, I'm not in slavery. Slavery happened many years ago before I was born, not right now. But as I was educated about it and was told what is human trafficking in my story, I was able to know that I was a victim of human trafficking. And sometimes some victims are also victims of domestic problems where there is the domestic thing going on. And sometimes for shelters, what they hear is domestic call. Or even when police come out, it's domestic. But when you dig further, we find out that there is human trafficking underneath it. And if we have any doctors or nurses here, when someone comes to them, clinic, you know, you need to start paying more attention. Who is with them? And also, apart from somebody being with them or telling someone to leave them, they don't need to talk to them. Please show love as you carry on your work, because you never know. The person who rescued me was a public health nurse. And I tell you, I did not see anything to her for over a year that she was working with me. So victims will not speak to you until they have built trust in you. And if you are asking questions and the question seems like crazy, then they will shut up and start lying, because victims are trained to lie. They will be lying to you. They will keep lying. And you will be wondering, okay, I can't figure this out. But when you show love and you are asking not as if you are probing, but you are asking like someone who cares, then you open up to you. Because it's in plain sight and we don't see it, what are the things to look out for? So these are some of the social behavior. Does the person look fearful? In fact, fear is the number one red flag for a victim of human trafficking. They speak, but they don't speak with their mouth. They speak with their eyes, and they speak with their body. So, look for the non-verbal cues. Does that person look frightful always? Does that person look like, oh, the world is coming to an end? But if we don't pay attention to this, we will not be able to find out that anything is going on. And then, does the victim refer to another person to speak for him or her, especially for foreign-born victims. And even sometimes here, for those that go through sex trafficking and things, the pimp will be the one speaking all the time. The person will not speak. Somebody else will be the one speaking on behalf of that person. And if the person is speaking, the person is just telling lies. And even lies that you can detect that, okay, this doesn't make sense, it doesn't add up. So when it doesn't add up, that is when you need to start paying more attention. And then, does the victim show signs of physical or sexual abuse, physical restraint, confinement, or torture? You know, in my case, I was pregnant, and I thank God for my child today. He's alive and healthy. My belly was growing, but my body wasn't growing. I said pregnant woman. And they didn't know why. They couldn't figure out. They didn't know that I didn't have access to enough food as a pregnant woman. So you need to be watching out for those underlying factors. And has the victim been harmed or deprived of food, water, sleep, and does the victim have few or no personal possessions? In my case, I didn't have much. I didn't have winter boots. I didn't have winter shoes. I didn't have winter coats. You know, those are some of the things to be paying attention to in Minnesota. In this kind of weather, for someone not to have winter boots or winter coat, so we need to be paying attention. Can the victim freely contact friends or family? In that one, how do you know if the victim can contact friends or family? It's by asking questions, but not in a probing way. You have to ask. There is difference between, oh, how are you today? And how is your family? Do you have families here? That, okay, do you have any family here? Who are you living with? You know, there is a way you will ask the question that will make the victim feel confident to talk to you. And then does the victim have freedom of movement? In my case, I didn't have freedom of movement. In fact, when I was going to the clinic, it was the insurance right that would take me. And, you know, those are some of the things you need to pay attention to. Sometimes somebody is coming to the clinic and it's the insurance right that is bringing that person. But the person is not living alone, especially a pregnant woman. Victim's family, have they been threatened? You know, you can't know that whether somebody's family has been threatened, except you have built some kind of rapport. The person, for the person to have confidence to talk to you. And then work conditions and immigration factors. Does the person work for long hours? Like when you are chatting with somebody and ask, oh, do you work? How long does your work take? In my case, sometimes I'm on my feet braiding hair for 7 hours. Sometimes I'm braiding for 14 hours. And I have not eaten, I'm just there, braiding there, while somebody is collecting the money. And sometimes when I'm doing the braiding, I had my son tied to my back, because I'm caring for him at the same time that I'm braiding here. If the victim is a juvenile that is engaged in commercial sex, I am glad now that we are passing a law to protect children. Because, you know, many of those kids have records that they can't use to move on with their life. So this needs to change so that they can be rescued and they can move on with their life. Part of what the law will be giving to them is the power of their freedom and power to be what they want to be. We have children here today, ask them what they want to be. I don't think any one of them will tell you that I want to be a prostitute. I don't think so. So how come when they get to teenagers, they become prostitutes and we label them as prostitutes? We need to be paying attention to all this. And then was the victim recruited for one purpose and forced to engage in another thing? That happens a lot to foreign-born victims, where some people, you think they're coming here to work and you come to something else. In my case, even though I came to work and my husband then encouraged me to stay, instead, he didn't do what he promised. He changed the whole thing. And before I knew it, I was a victim of labor trafficking. And then, is the victim paying salary to somebody? Is wages being garnished by someone? Because, like I told you before, that someone could be smuggled in, but after that, you know, the person might become a victim of human trafficking. Where the arrangement changes when the person gets here. For a small good in person, is he or she supposed to just pay and go and work freely and do whatever he or she likes? But sometimes some of them will get here and they will be confined from doing what they want. Instead, they will tell them, oh, okay, the amount has changed. You have to pay more. And then you start making them to work and taking their salary. And then as the victim is forced to perform sexual acts, you know, the people will call prostitutes. And then as the victim be threatened with deportation of the law, yes. In my case, I was threatened with the police, and I was threatened with immigration. And in fact, the police was called on me. And that was what made me to jump from the frying pan into the fire. And I'm glad that I made that jump, because that is what happens to victims most of the time. They will keep taking it, but when they have to make the decision, they're not sure what is going to happen. And because I had a child I was holding on to, I didn't want what happened to me to happen to him. Organ trafficking happens all across the world, including Minnesota. In fact, somebody died in Minnesota. If you go to our website and watch the full interview, you will hear about the guy who died in Minnesota. So it's something that is happening all over. It is not something that is more prevalent in one country than the other. And even also, I will say that one type of human trafficking is not more prevalent than the other. But the challenge we have is that one is being reported more than the other. I'm glad to let you know that any consultory is partnered with the National Human Resource Center. And these are resources for you. If you suspect somebody might be a victim of human trafficking, please call us. That is our number. And if you want us to come out and do a training or speak at your event, no group is too small, even if it's just one person that wants to know. Part of what we do as an organization is referral. So we will refer to lawyers. For example, our guest speaker is a lawyer. So we will be referring to our organization and other organizations that provide services to victims of human trafficking. And then also we do, because we want survivors to get their life back and their power back, it's important for us to empower survivors. So we're looking for a common ground to bring survivors and the community. We have what we call the empowerment circle. We have it every month, and what we do is we look for a topic that is common to everybody, whether the person is a victim of human trafficking or not, so that we can start using that to be bridging the gap to empower survivors. We focus on a particular topic. This month, we are focusing on financial empowerment. So everybody wants to know something about finance. But then we use this avenue to bring nobody in the group to write on it to our head that I'm a survivor of trafficking, but we bring this common ground to empower survivors. And we are going to be starting a community garden this spring, because especially for those who are foreign born, one of the issues they have is with the food. For me, when I was getting help at Alexandra House, I was there. Usually the shelter is for a month, 30 days to 40 days, something like that. But then I was there for 8 months. So those shelters are taking on a lot, because what we think the shelter is for, the shelter is way more than that in the actual sense. For someone like me who had legal issues, the shelter is the only place I could stay at. I didn't have anybody, I didn't know anybody. But the shelter was taking care of me and my child for a solid 8 months that we were there until, because for a foreign born, there is all the issues to go to. And I'm sure that you will hear a lot about that from our guest speaker today. So this past December we went to Alexandra's house because I still call Alexandra as my family home. You know, it's the place where they gave me my life back and my freedom back. So, and I believe in giving back to help somebody else. That is what gave them to this organization. And we went back there in December with 9 volunteers and we cooked dinner for them. And it was a Nigerian menu. So we want, you know, America is a diverse country. And we cannot stop immigration into this country. People will keep immigrating, and we want everybody to feel the love. And food for those who are going through any form of abuse or torture or human trafficking, food is very important for that kind of person. And to get even more comfort is when you are able to eat, even if it is one time or few times, the food that you are actually familiar with.
Hello, my name is Emily Wise. Please join Bukola in the fight against human trafficking by partnering with the Anytown Story. Their mission is to advocate for victims and empower survivors of human trafficking. For more information on that, you can go to or email info@anytown.org. Once a month, we have the Empowerment Circle. You can find more about the Empowerment Circle on our website. Thank you for your time.
Took all of them, all these kids, just for the wants and the needs. I pray for the souls. Imprisoned shore.
First of all, I would be remiss if I did not thank Bukola for the opportunity to be here today. We have, as a result of her hard work, been able to do so many presentations like this to groups big and small, and that has helped us not only advocate for victims, but also identify new victims due to the referral system. One of the things to keep in mind is, while we're getting a lot of information today about human trafficking victims, they are watched all the time because the reason human trafficking is so widespread is that you can sell a human being over and over and over again. And so that one human being is worth so much money to a trafficker. And so it is a prized asset in a way, and they are not going to let that person go easily. So there are very few places that individual may be able to be seen. Maybe in a grocery store, maybe at a doctor's office, maybe in a church environment, very few places. And we all have to assume that when we see the signs that we talked about today, that Bukola talked about, that we think, you know, something's not right about this person. That we don't approach them in a public place in a way where the person who's watching them may assume that they are giving information, because that can endanger their lives severely. So just like domestic violence, where you have to be careful how you work with victims of domestic violence in a public way. Human trafficking is very similar. So when you are engaging with a person like that, not in a probing way, but in a really caring way, you want to do it in a private and protected space. And that's something we should all keep in mind. So we talked about why victims are so valuable. And what is interesting about human trafficking is that while there is no formal study that says exactly how many victims there are, we do know just from the trend data of the victims that have been identified that they are from all over the world, that we have domestic victims and we have international victims, and that they are men and they are women and they are children. And children are more complex because it is in our human nature to identify with the adult who appears to be sort of taking care of us. And so as a result, children sometimes will be the most ardent advocate for the trafficker, saying, that can't be true, they're not taking advantage of me. They really love me, that's why they make me do X, Y, Z. And so it is very, very hard. So there's a whole psychology area just dedicated to youth victims and the amount of care that needs to be given to those victims before they're able to speak, because they really have rationalized the kind of, you know, harm they've suffered. And we also see that, I do in my practice, because I practice in the area of immigration law, and a large amount of my practice is dedicated to victims of crime that are international. I also see that similar trend in women, where the men who have brought them here, the alleged traffickers, use marriage as a means to get them into the United States because it is quicker than otherwise. Because then that person has legal status to come into the United States, which is something that it is hard to smuggle people in. So they use that as a system. And what ends up happening is that individual wants to believe this is a real marriage. Even though all these crazy things are happening, they are being asked to work from sunrise to sunset. They may be asked to sleep with men other than their husband. All kinds of stuff is happening, but it's the rationalization to make it seem like, no, this person could not be betraying me. So that's another whole psychology of area where the mixture of domestic violence in a couple relationship combined with human trafficking is so complex. What I'm going to do today is, we can't get into the details of it, but I wanted to give you these tidbits so that in case you're interested, you kind of know that there is a lot more literature in this different areas. So where the legal system intersects with human trafficking, especially internationally, is that some victims come here through valid visas. Now, that visas may have been something they have secured because of themselves, like, I plan to come and visit the USA. My uncle told me that there is a friend he has in New York who has an apartment and I can go stay there for a week while I visit Central Park and the Statue of Liberty. And I have no idea what's going to happen to me when I get to that apartment. In other words, I'm truly thinking I'm a tourist, and then all this stuff happens. Otherwise, you have people who come here with illegitimate visas. So in other words, they're brought here using the US system, but they are brought here with a visa that is really not what they're going to be doing. So let's imagine somebody brought here as with a student visa, but once they get here, they are not entering a program. They're placed into labor trafficking where they're working, you know, in restaurants, or they're working in ethnic businesses, or any kind of situation like that. So you've got people coming here legally, and then something happens where they are then put into trafficking. And then there are people who are smuggled into the United States with immigration not knowing anything about them because they're brought through our porous borders. We have very porous borders. We do want to protect them, and I think we try our best to protect them, but they're porous nonetheless because we have so many people crossing them at any given time, and the northern border is actually, in my opinion, more porous than the southern one, because we don't expect somebody to canoe through the boundary waters to Minnesota from Canada. We just don't think about things like that. But that's something to keep in mind, is that the borders are porous from both sides. And some people have been moved, not just from their country to here, but through many stops along the way. So their immigration history is very complex. When I get called and say, you know, this person may be a victim of human trafficking, there are two scenarios I'm emotionally prepared for. Either he or she is a victim of sex trafficking, in which case, you know, sometimes it's shocking when you meet someone like that. They don't always fit the profile. So the government's advertisements show a person, like their advertisements show a person sitting in a corner like this. That's kind of what we imagine, right? But if somebody has had to sleep with 60, 70, 80 people a week and survive, they're not going to be sitting in that corner. They have mentally prepared to be a survivor. They may be really tough when we meet them. So part of our challenge is to help them trust us after they've been violated in that way. And so that could be one type of person. The other type of person I could see is a victim of labor trafficking. The most common ones we see are domestic servants. And the reason that area is so complex, or sometimes even people working in a small business setting where they know something is wrong, but they don't know what they can do about it because the country they come from, there are no labor laws to protect you. So if your boss says you gotta sleep here in the building, wake up at 6 a.m., work till 11 p.m., and then go back and sleep in that place, in their mind, it seems wrong, but they don't know what they can do about it. So labor trafficking is where somebody has taken advantage of a person by making them work either for no pay or for just absolutely minuscule pay, or they pay you and then they take the money back because they're providing you a cot, and therefore you have to pay for your cot and your food, and you have no freedom of movement or very limited freedom of movement. By the time you see the victim, they may be malnourished, they may have physical health issues. A common one that ends up identifying somebody is dental issues. You know, we don't think about that, but when you've got a bad dental problem, you almost can't do anything else. You have to take care of yourself. And so the trafficker might bring them to a establishment, and then that's where somebody says, you know, something's not right about that person. And in that safe space may identify them as possibly a victim. But all of these types of scenarios is what we can face. So when we meet them, the first thing we have to do is ensure that that we're not causing any more harm. So be very passive to some extent, caring, and not ask too many questions in that first visit, but just to kind of be there and be available and say, I'm just here, whatever you need to say, I'm just here to listen. And it takes often many visits before you actually peel the onion and get the actual story of what's happening. Now at that time, in our country, the Department of Homeland Security is given the responsibility of vetting whether a person is a true victim or not. So the next thing we have to do is bring them to the Immigration Service, which is a very scary thing. And then they are interviewed by an officer who spends most of their time catching bad guys. they have to sort of shift gear from I'm here to go catch people to deport them to, oh, and this person is a victim, so I have to now shift gear. And it's a very hard thing. If you think about human nature, you've got a function you do every day, and then every once in a while, your function is exactly the other way. You have to be emotive, you have to be available. It's very hard. They have to go through that interview, and then the government has to make one or two decisions. Either they believe you, or they're just not sure. And if they don't believe you, I still have the ability as an attorney to file for that person's possible trafficking visa so that they can remain in the USA, so that we can help them get to a better place than where they are now. Because for many of them, they can't return home because the traffickers know where they live and their families face danger and there's all kinds of complications. So for many of them, the only option they have is to remain here. And if Homeland Security does not believe them, then we are still allowed to file, but the burden is on us to prove that they're a victim. If Homeland Security does believe them and wants to investigate, they have the ability to give them some legal status right away and then to support their case to get the visa, in which case the burden is quite a bit lower. So a lot of this depends upon their resources and their willingness to investigate. And a lot of the dance that advocates do in Homeland Security is this dance of, please investigate, this person really needs services, and sometimes they're just not able to. And so we often end up, more often than not, we end up filing without their support and securing approvals by having to present a lot more evidence. Very hard to do when somebody has escaped a situation. They can't go back and get an affidavit from a trafficker that all this really happened. They can't go get pictures of the room that they were in. So we have to use secondary evidence like Google Maps, and we have to use affidavits from people who helped rescue them, and from psychologists and things like that to build the case. And it's a difficult task. But I think the system is getting better, and I think we have more and more officers getting better training on how to shift gear. And it is an unfair thing to ask of them, in all fairness, to have somebody whose job be catching illegal people all day, and then they have to also interview and care for human trafficking victims. It's a very different kind of mental outlook. But I think the system is moving in the right direction. That is one road that we can take. The other road we can take is that we have something called U visas in the United States. We only have 10,000 of them, but that's for victims of several types of crimes, including human trafficking. Not just human trafficking. It can be, felonious assault. It can be domestic violence. Many, many, many crimes. So sometimes what ends up happening is we are lucky enough that the law enforcement at the local level really believes that this person is a victim, and they're willing to sign off that they are investigating. And if they are willing to investigate, the person may be eligible for this U visa. There's only 10,000 of them, so there's a huge backlog in Homeland Security with all these people who have applied, but they don't have enough slots to approve them, even though they believe all these people, but they just don't have enough slots. But at least that's our backup plan. So the T visa, which is the straight trafficking visa with the support of Homeland Security or not, or the U visa, which is for a whole lot of crimes, are the two big tools we have. However, sometimes you end up with all kinds of other tools like asylum. Somebody who has maybe escaped their country because they fear persecution, that if they return back, something bad would happen. And so they escape from their country, and because they're trying to escape, they're very vulnerable. And so it is an ideal person for somebody who wants to take advantage of someone else to prey on that person because they have no place else to go. When we allow a victim to remain in the USA by getting one of these visas, we allow for their immediate family. So if they are a minor, then their parents, siblings. If they are an adult, then their spouse and their children, to be able to join them because we need to protect them from whatever wrath comes up because they have spoken up. And communities are very tight-knit, especially within the international communities, very tight-knit. So the word does get out sometimes, and it's very hard for the people who are left back home with no protections. So that's how, that's why those laws are there. Now, when the victims have been here for 3 years, and they have cooperated with law enforcement for whatever law enforcement has needed from them, in some cases their cooperation results in indictments or prosecution of the traffickers. That's the purpose of the visas, is we want them to be secure enough that they can actually be witnesses to the state so they can get these people off the streets that are committing these crimes. If they spend 3 years in the United States assisting law enforcement or being available to law enforcement, then they are allowed to apply for permanent residence and remain in the USA. And it's many people like that, in my mind, who end up spreading the word about human trafficking because now they're safe enough that they can do it. Whereas if you're always at risk of going back home, you don't know if you can say anything because while the U.S. laws may protect you, nobody's protecting you. What Homeland Security has done that's really wonderful is they've said that it doesn't matter if we're only allowed 10,000 visas, we will accept applications from as many law enforcement people as they want to send to us so that those people can at least remain here and assist law enforcement, because otherwise if we turn down those applications, we didn't even take them in, those people would have nothing And then how can they fight and show up to court when they're risking deportation every day? You know, it's a scary place to be. So the reason that these laws even came to be is because we wanted law enforcement to have tools to prosecute people. And we wanted these victims to feel safe enough to do so. And that is why, you know, those visas exist. So that gives you an overview of kind of how we support human trafficking victims.
Hello, my name is Emily Wise. Please join Bukola in the fight against human trafficking by partnering with the Anytown Story. Their mission is to advocate for victims and empower survivors of human trafficking. For more information on that, you can go to or email info@anytown.org. Once a month, we have the Empowerment Circle. You can find more about the Empowerment Circle on our website. Thank you for your time.
Took all of them, all these kids, just for the wants and the needs. I pray for the souls.
The entire month of January is Human Trafficking Awareness Month, so be on the lookout. I'm sure there are other events around your community, in the Twin Cities area. You might be interested in going to those. But the Anytown Story have a few upcoming events that I'd like to share with you. You've heard that Bukola is actually going to Washington, D.C. for the Survivors Forum at the White House. So we're excited about that, and she does have a blog, so she will be blogging, I believe, from Washington, and she can get a chance to do that, so you might want to check it out. Also, she will be doing a presentation at Calvary Baptist Church, which will be on the 26th, is that correct?
Yes.
Which is Sunday the 26th at Calvary. Also, she will be at a vendor empowerment, Empowerment 2014. It's a two-day event showcase, and we'll have a table there, the Anytown Story. And I believe that will be on the 24th and 25th. So there's some handouts that you can grab if you're interested in that. And then our Empowerment Circle, which is a support group type, is starting January 31st will be our first one, and we will be focusing on financial empowerment. And then human trafficking awareness training on February 15th and March 15th. So more information will be provided. You can always check out the website. It's www.anytown.org.
Hello, my name is Emily Wise. Please join Bukola in the fight against human trafficking by partnering with the Anytan Story. Their mission is to advocate for victims and empower survivors of human trafficking. For more information on that, you can go to or email info@anytan.org. Once a month, we have the Empowerment Circle. You can find more about the Empowerment Circle on our website. Thank you for your time.
Took all of them, all these kids, just for the wants and the needs. I pray for the souls. Imprisoned show. Can you believe that they took me from home. Can you believe that they took me from my home? Can you believe that this could happen? I don't know. Oh, oh, oh. I'm just a little boy. Nobody loves little me. And I need to just keep on praying to my father.
We light this candle in honor of victims who have lost their lives as a result of human trafficking, and we hope that their soul rests in perfect peace.
I'm supposed to be your son. All they do is just treat me so bad. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I wanna live my life and live it forever, but they keep on bringing me back to this place. They trafficking me. They trafficking me all around this world. Wanted to talk to God today to say, help me get up out of this place you made. I can't believe you put me in this situation, but I know you can move mountains for me. Oh, this a house. I don't wanna be in no more. They keep on just trafficking of me and just wanna walk out the door. Help me get up out of this place. I just don't wanna live in this house no more. Trafficking me around the whole wide world. I feel like I'm a slave in this modern time. It's 2013. Just don't know how this world could be this way anymore. They're just trafficking little boys and girls all around the whole wide world. Yeah. Just trying to tell a story to you now about my whole life and how they took me from my home and put me into this place. They sold me for just a couple cents, I know. Help me get home, help me get home. I don't wanna be in this place no more. Help me get home, help me get home. I don't wanna be in this place no more.
Kids, send your flag. Here comes Angie.